For this example, I would like to show you how to find a critical value or a t-value needed for a confidence interval for the population mean when sigma is unknown. So my first example is finding a t-value for when n is equal to 12 and our level of confidence is 0.95. So to sketch what that represents, is I have a bell-shaped distribution. The t-distribution is bell-shaped with a mean of 0, but its exact look depends on the degrees of freedom. So the t-distribution tends to be a little bit shorter and wider than the z-interval. But as our sample size increases, the t-distribution approaches the normal distribution. So I have a bell-shaped distribution. I put 0 in the middle. If n is equal to 12, then my degrees of freedom is n minus 1, or 12 minus 1, which is 11. And if I have a level of confidence of 0.95, that means I have 95% or 0.95 amount of area between two symmetric t-values. And the one you need for the formula, if you choose to do this by hand, is this upper one. You can use the other one, but your confidence interval limits will be switched. Your larger one will be first, so make sure that you switch them back if you somehow find the lower one. Now, if you're taking my class, the current t-table we use only gives the upper critical value, so you should be it shouldn't be very confusing. So we have 95% of amount of area between these two symmetric t values. Because the total area under the curve is 1, that means that 5% would be left over in these tails symmetrically, and each individual tail would have 0.025 amount of area. So summing up all three of these values, you would get 1, or 100%. Okay, so if you're taking my class, the book uses this notation. Okay, so this value here, this critical value, is t sub 1 minus alpha over 2, comma, degrees of freedom. Okay. So it might be easier, if you don't want to get bogged down in notation, it might be easier just to sketch the bell-shaped distribution, recognize the fact that the level of confidence represents the center area, and then you're going to have the symmetric amount of area in each of these tails. Okay, so right here, this shaded area further to the right is the area we need when we look at our table. So if you look at this table, and I know it's a little hard to read. They print this very, very small. Area to the right of the critical value. Okay, so sketching it helps you figure out how much area is to the right. So if our level of confidence is 0.95, whoops, if there's a 0.95, I shouldn't have a percent symbol there. Okay. Or I could say, or 95%. Okay, my apologies about that. Okay, or 90%. All right, so I know how much area I want to the right of this critical value. So I want to read down to my degrees of freedom, which is 11 in this case, and over to the column that corresponds to 0.025. Okay, so again, the print is very small. All right, so here, this says t sub 0.025. All right, so intersecting that row and that column, I get a value of 2.201. Okay, so 2.201 is my critical value for this first one. For my second one, I have a confidence level of 0.9, or I'm finding a 90% confidence interval. Again, putting 0 in the middle and partitioning the area under the bell curve, under the t-distribution, such that I have 90% between two symmetric t-values. So this means that this tail here would have 0.05 amount of area, and this tail would have 0.05 amount of area. So this tells me how much area I have to the right of this mystery critical value. So if my sample size is 5, then my degrees of freedom will be 4. So again, going back to the t-table, reading down to 4 degrees of freedom and over to t sub 0.05, because that's how much area is to the right or is in that upper tail, I get a value of 2.132. In my next video, I will show you how to get the same information using the TI-84 calculator.